Ishwarya Chaitanya is a Bharatanatyam dancer and a yoga teacher. Ishwarya Chaitanya completed her Arangetram under Guru Sri Jai Govinda of Vancouver, Canada. Born and raised in Vancouver, Ishwarya's passion for dance brought her to Karnataka, Kala Shri Guru B. Bhanumati of Bangalore, under whom she has been training for the past 10 years. After completing her MFA in dance from Shastra University under the guidance of the legendary Dr. Padma Subramanyam, Ishwarya became a member of Guru Bhanumati's internationally renowned troupe, Bharatanjali, and has performed all over India in many major festivals and events. She is also a certified yoga instructor and therapist. Over the next hour, or slightly more than an hour, Ishwarya will take us on a journey which will connect the wonderful dance form of Bharatanatyam to devotion. Friends, let us all welcome Ishwarya Chaitanya to the next level of Vedic Wisdom Festival.
Namaste. Thank you so much for the wonderful introduction, Sureshji. My pranams to Swamiji. Swaminiji, thank you so much for having me here on such an esteemed platform. And it has really touched my heart that you feel I would be worthy of it. So thank you so much. My pranams to everybody who has joined us today. Thank you for being here. I'm Aishwarya. And Swamiji gave me the topic, From Dance to Devotion. So I'd like to speak for some time about it before I present. So devotion, if we define as surrender, bhakti is surrender. Dance brings about that in so many levels. So just now Swamiji was talking about how he obtains the quiet in during chaos, during a tense situation, due to the practice of Kalaripayattu. Not just quietitude you will gain through the practice of dance, but all of the aspects of sadhana is there in dance. You start at a very early age, you know, when you're 6, 7, preferably little older, 8 or 9. And the dance practice primarily has to do with training the body. And you gain mastery over the body, over your sense organs, because the teachers will be so strict in general. So today your leg is paining, doesn't matter. Move on, continue. Tomorrow your thighs are paining, it's okay. Everybody's thighs are paining, continue. Day after tomorrow you broke your leg, it's okay. Do abhinaya. So there is no stop to it. You cannot stop it. You cannot stop the practice. Even if you stop the practice, if you have given sufficient amount of time to the art itself blesses you and brings you back, like what has happened for me today with all of you. So starting from the early age, we make and break the body so that, as Dr. Padma Subramanyam once told us in her lecture, that you train the body in order to forget it. So that is the practice of training. And that has to happen over a long period of time. And when is it that you, what does it mean to forget the body? So the dance training and performance ultimately has to result in what we call rasa or rasananda. And rasananda is when you have the culmination or the joining of what is known as vibhava, anubhava, and vyavichari bhava. So this world that we live in, we all know, is called bhavasagara. It is this world of tumultuous emotions, and there are so many waves, and there are hurricanes, and there are tsunamis, and we experience all of this in the bhavasagara of our life. For what? For what purpose? So that is in dance, to gain that experience of rasa, or that experience where the vibhava, anubhava, vyavichari join into one, and there is no duality, even in dance, even in the performance. So we strive towards that non-duality, where you are not your body, you are not your mind, you are not the character that you are portraying, you just are. And that is how the dance develops, and how that is how we that is what we aim for through the practice. And the classical art has been so beautifully structured to help us in this way. So as I said earlier, we start with all the adavus, you know, they break your thighs, they break your legs, they break your arms. And you know, as a child, you have the ability to do it without much problem. And then you start introducing little concepts, one Ganesha Kautvam, one small, you know, little bit of lyric along with the dance, so that the child knows, okay, there is somebody called Ganesha, there is somebody called Saraswati, and these are beings we must admire, we must respect. And so they start developing at a young age that devotion to God through their dance. Because for most children, it's difficult to sit still. So if you ask them to recite Saraswati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarupini, they'll be moving back and forth, and they'll be, you know, scratching their leg and whatnot. But you ask them to dance that, so then everything becomes still, because now everybody is watching. And so that idea of, okay, Saraswati, she holds a veena, she wears white, all of this, all these concepts start, the seeds of those concepts are put in when they are quite young. After that, they start learning little more complex pieces, which involve more rhythmical complexity, more swaras, more lyrics, and then mature lyrics. So the concept of Shringara is brought in as the child matures, becomes a teenager, becomes a young adult. And whatever is there in the loka, whatever is there to experience in this world, is brought out in dance. And nothing is considered vulgar. Everything is sacred. Even the relationship between a courtesan and client is not considered vulgar in the art. And that is what is so beautiful, that this art form was so open-minded, it was so broad and all-encompassing, that things which are considered, how can you call that classical? How can you call a courtesan a classical, bring that into the classical context? But the art was like that. Everything was brought in, and everything was explored to its maximum potential, and still it is. And finally, the dance culminates in a tillana, which is again, you know, a pure nritta or pure dance piece. But finally, what we wish for happens in the mangalam, which is, we wish, as Bharatamani, who has written the Natyashastra, it is the biggest and most vast literature on dance and drama that exists today. And after describing all aspects, not just dance steps and dance movements, but the rhythm, the music, string instruments, wind instruments, what types of percussion instruments, how percussion came about, types of poetry, types of meters that you find in poetry, types of stages that can be built, how the characters should be dressed, how the queen should be dressed, what specific jewelry, what specific costume the heroine wears versus a jester, what he would wear. So how the procedure for building an auditorium, what the person who is constructing the auditorium, what are the penances and practices that person has to perform in order to do the Bhumi Puja to the auditorium. To that extent, Bharata Muni has gone into such great detail in the Natyashastra. And after all of this, finally he says, let there be rain, let there be greenery, let the sun shine, let the cows be protected, and let everybody be happy. And the purpose of the art was just that, was to bring about a sense of happiness in the artist as well as the onlooker. So the short story of how the Natya came about is that the Devas found that people are now indulging in things which are starting to become little adharmic. That balance between dharma and adharma is going towards adharma. So how is it that we can keep ourselves entertained in a positive way so that we don't give in to the vices that are just hanging around, to grab us? And so they went to Brahma, and Brahmaji took lyrics, he took from Rig Veda, and music he took from Samaveda. The idea of rasa he took from Atharva Veda, and all of the hand gestures, everything from Yajurveda. And combining all these, he created the Natya Veda. And he found these devas are too pleasure seeking, so they may not be the best candidates to learn this art form, because you have to be somebody who has that titiksha. Without that, you just cannot attempt to be an artist. Because whether it is raining, whether it is snowing, whether your body is aching, whether you have a fever, you have to be able to continue the sadhana. Which is why he chose Bharata Muni and taught this art to him. And it was meant as an audio-visual practice and an audio-visual education, which entertains as well as elevates. So these are the two main aspects of Natya. And I can say that as a practitioner, even if you have left it for a period of time, the art cannot leave you, because it is Saraswati. You are blessed. You are blessed to have the art in your life. And also to be a dancer requires some amount of madness also. Without that, it's not possible. The kind of things that we go through for a performance or going to rehearsals and sometimes multiple rehearsals in a day. And sometimes it depends how the organizer would have arranged the program. So I remember once we had performed in a village. I can't remember the name now. It was the end of their Satyanarayan Katha. So the whole village, like 2,000, 3,000 people were there. But the stage was just these planks of wood that had been placed together. I don't think they had bolted it down also. And then one carpet was laid on top of it. So these are not things that we can foresee beforehand. But we have come, we are prepared, and we still have to perform. Sometimes there will be pouring rain. We had in Narsipura, Hole Narsipura, one beautiful temple is there. And just as we had to start, pouring rain, and the stage is outdoors. So what do you do? And what do the people do? Nothing. They are all there to enjoy. So we waited 2 hours, 3 hours. Finally, we started around 10:30 in the night. We started our performance. But it was so beautiful because the lighting was actually much better than if we had done in the day with daylight. So, and the beauty of performing in India also is that people are also there to watch, even if it is 10:30 in the night, because the lifestyle, at least in these villages, the lifestyle is different. It's much more organic, flowing, and natural. And those are all things that we learn in dance. It's not just about doing the adavus and learning items and then going on stage. Those are one part of it, which is a nice part of it. But the other part of it is how to let go, how to be in the moment, how to adapt. You have to have, you will learn the ability to adapt to people, to situations, and it sort of churns you. Like it is a constant Amrita Manthana that is going on inside you all the time when you are in the pursuit of art. Because there are so many aspects of your personality that need refinement. And that happens because at the end of the day, because we love the dance, because we are devoted to the dance, and because you have surrendered to the dance, then the art itself tests you to see what is the extent to which you have surrendered. And you are faced with all kinds of situations, and you have to have that surrender to God. And even if not God, even if those who don't believe in God, there are people who dance Bharatanatyam who are of other religions. It doesn't matter, because art is beyond all of these sort of barriers, because it is an expression of everything that we experience. And everything that we experience is made, like Swamiji said, spiritualized. It is made sacred. And sometimes, and those are given names like Shiva, Vishnu, Parvati, but we have to transcend the form of those names and the itself in order to experience the true meaning behind what we are doing. And therefore, I'll just conclude by saying that there's two aspects of devotion. One is devotion to the art form itself. And the second is when you surrender to the, if you consider the art itself as the Lord, or you consider the Lord, whichever your Lord is, your Ishta Devata, or if you have a broader concept of Godhood as most people in this platform probably would. There are those two levels of surrender. And then you understand that the Vibhava, Anubhava, Vyavichari Bhava. So Vibhava, once Dr. Padma Subramaniam had asked me during our exam in the MFA, she said, what is the Vibhava? So our textbook answer I gave, which is Vibhava is the cause. And she said, what is that? And then I did not have an answer beyond that, because that's all we had read in the textbook. So that I just told that. So she said, the Vibhava is Narayana. And he is the cause. Then I understood, he is the cause. The Anubhava, that which follows, which is what we experience, whatever sthai we are experiencing, sthai bhava is, you can have a sthai of sadness, or you might have a sthai of elation, whatever the sthai is. That Anubhava is also nothing but Narayana, because Narayana is the cause. Finally, the Vyavichari Bhavas, or the ones which come and go, you know, a heroine, she might be in viraha, she might be missing her lover or her lord. So her sthai is that she is sad, she is melancholic. And in that sadness, she goes through waves of emotions, because as she remembers their time together, then she feels happy. Then again, she remembers, oh, but he is not there. And then she remembers, oh, but this time he did like this, I'm so upset. And then again, she comes back to her Shringara. So all of these Vyavichari Bhavas, which we experience, all of us on a day-to-day basis, even those are but Narayana. And that is why when all three we take as Narayana, then the, you know, Narayana plus Narayana plus Narayana equals Narayana only. And that is how this art form helps us to grow in understanding of the Shastra, by giving us very practical experiences that we have to go through on a day-to-day basis as we are, when we are practitioners of the art. And even if you leave it for a period of time, as I did do for the last year, even if you leave it, you cannot fully leave it, because the art is forever with you, just as Narayana is forever with you. So dance is nothing but devotion. It is not separate from that. You don't go from dance to devotion at the end, because it is just that. There is only one thing there. And that has been a beautiful experience, of course, a journey to understand. And it has made me more subtle, refined, not just me, I cannot say me, a person in general, becomes much more subtle, much more refined, sensitive, and humble when you look at the vastness of what has been given to us by our rishis. With that, I will now present the first piece, Hanumanta Devanamo, written by Saint poet Purandara Dasa. Even Purandara Dasa's journey into bhakti has been a very beautiful one, very interesting one. And I won't go too much into that story, but the beauty is that it is a bhakta who has written about a bhakta. So Purandara Dasa, bhakta of Narayana, has written about Hanuman in this piece, where Hanuman is the most valorous, most powerful of all superheroes. There's no Batman, Superman, nobody compares to the amount of power that Hanuman yields. And yet, what is he? He is devoted to Rama, and he surrenders all of his, whatever he has. He says it is only Rama. So that Dasya Bhakti that we see in Hanuman of complete and total surrender is something very unique. And in this piece, Hanuman is glorified, and he is the one who crosses the ocean in order to slay the demons. He is the one who is always protecting Rama and Lakshmana, standing as a guard. He is the one, at the drop of a hat, he will do whatever Rama asks him, and goes all the way to Lanka to give the ring to Rama's ring to Sita, where she blesses him with all the siddhis and buddhis. And he is the one who Madhvacharya praises, and he is the beloved of Lakshmi and Vishnu. And this is Hanuman. And one small story I would like to share about Hanuman, because this is one Ashavidya platform. So Swami Pratyak Bodhananji, who I remember very fondly always, he had told one small story of after the Pattabhishekam. So Sita is in the bedroom with Rama, and she's pressing his feet. And Hanuman, who is always has become so accustomed to being by Rama's side, he does not even think, and he goes into the room. And Rama is nicely pretending to sleep. He has his eyes closed. And Sita says, "What are you doing here?" He says, "I am Ramadasa, I am here." "No, I am his wife. So I have the authority to be here in his room." Hanuman does not understand. Then Sita says, "You see this sindoor? This allows me, gives me the right to be here. You can go now." Hanuman then, he doesn't have an answer. So he goes, and then he covers his whole body with sindoor and comes back. So that is the level of devotion of Hanuman, pure and unbound. So without further ado, I will present Hanumanta Devanamo.
Hanumanta Devanamo. Hanumanta Devanamo. Namo
was about Sri Hanuman. The next piece is Jagadodharana, which again Purandaradasa Kriti, which describes the love between Yashoda and Krishna. And this has been beautifully choreographed by Padma Bhushan Srimati Kalanidhi Narayanan to depict the contrast of Krishna, Natkat Krishna, and the Lord Narayana. So she says that the one who upholds this entire universe, as a small child, Yashoda confuses him to be. The Lord of the whole universe Look at what he's doing. He's stealing butter in the dark without his mother's knowledge. He is the one who is without a second, the one who lies on Adishesha. And Yashoda catches hold of him and tries to scare him, saying, "Will you go out? There are snakes outside in the forest." So like this, the contrast is again and again brought out very beautifully in the choreography. The one who you do puja to, the one whom you try to study in the Shastra, the one for whom you do all kinds of tapas, and you don't get him. And here he is, grazing the cows, playing with the gopis, teasing Mother Yashoda. He is right here in front of you as your own child, as your own mother. Jagadodharana in Kapi Ragam, choreographed by Padma Bhushan, Srimati Kalanidhi Narayanan. This was taught to my guru, Guru B. Bhanumati, who has imparted it to us. It is a very dear piece, because it shows that Vatsalya Bhakti, which any mother would have for the child. And here Vatsalya, the ultimate we see is always the example which is given, is Yashoda, because she is there for each and every part of Krishna's upbringing. And she loves him, she plays with him, she scolds him, and she ties him to the mortar because she's so fed up. But no matter what, just one smile is enough to melt her heart. And that form of devotion to the child is another form of bhakti. And what happens when we learn this art form is it transcends more than just the piece and the performance. It starts to transcend into our lives, because it forces us to look at situations in, is there another way to look at this situation? It gives us that ability to discriminate. Without further ado, Jagadodharana.
Manikyana Adisidhani Shoda
Jagadodharana. So much can be spoken about that one piece. It is truly deep and philosophical, as well as light and jovial. It has both contrasts in it. It is one of my favorite pieces which I have learned from Guru Bibhanmati. The last piece that I'll be presenting is our Pujya Swamiji's Bho Shambho, and I had the privilege of dancing it in front of him. And it is, of course, every dancer, every singer, every artist's favorite song since it has been composed and retuned by Sri Maharaj Puram Santanam Ji. And in this piece, we have my guru Sheila Chandrasekhar. She has choreographed it in a very beautiful way, involving some concepts from our Shastra. So it starts off describing Shiva as Gangadhara, one who is all-encompassing, one who is everywhere in all beings. He is that Pashupate. He is the one who lies in the hearts of those who are pure. He is the one, Digambaresha. And finally, it culminates. So Shiva, the concept of Shiva for a dancer is multiply layered. So first we start off with the anthropomorphized form of Shiva, which is Nataraja, the one who has the jata, the one for whom Ganga is flowing from his head, the one whose consort is Parvati, the one who wears the tiger skin around his waist, the one who has a damaru, who has a trishula, who has the crescent moon on his head. And this concept is actually detailed to such an extent, even in the Tamil scriptures where they describe for every day of the month, there is a different moon which is on the head of Lord Shiva. So that Chandrasekhara actually is the name of Shiva on a particular day when the moon is of that particular shape. Lord Shiva has so many types of hairstyles, so flowers which adorn his head. He has different rupas. He has the Saumya Rupa, he has the Aghora Rupa, and all forms are brought into this one form of Shiva, who is human-like. Shiva with the left leg dancing, Shiva with his right leg lifted, Shiva with Abhaya Mudra. And we contemplate on the image of Lord Shiva as a dancer for a very, very, very long time. And then we come to the, that is the Rupa form of Lord Shiva. Then there is the Rupa Rupa form, which is form, that formless form, which sounds contradictory. But that is the Shiva which is worshipped as the Linga. And in Chidambaram temple, he is worshipped as the Spatika Linga. So when you go to Chidambaram, you will see these three forms of Shiva. So one is the Nataraja, Chidambaram Nataraja, which is very well known, very famous. And then you have the Spatika Linga, which is what is worshipped, where the Abhisheka is done on a daily basis. And this linga is at night time taken to the Devi's sthalam, and he is kept there with the Devi, with the Shakti, to rest in the night, and he is brought back. So actually even the hasta for Shiva, so we show like this, he comes out. Even the Swami, he is, the Shikhara comes out from the Shakti. So you cannot have the Shiva without the Shakti. That is the Rupa Rupa form. And finally, we get to the Arupa, formless, which is represented in Chidambaram as the Chidambaram Rahasya, which is the Akashalinga. And here, next to the Garbhagudi of the Nataraja, there is another part to it, where there is a garland of bilwa leaves. Silver or gold, I can't remember, I think silver. And you cannot see the end of it. It goes off into space. So that is how they have represented the formless form of Lord Shiva. And this is how we transcend the layers of worship, forward and backward as well, to accept that everything, in order to accept that everything is Ishvara, we must accept that every form is Ishvara. And Ishvara is not just that which we try to transcend to and achieve as this abstract, formless entity. He pervades everything. And that is told to us in the form of the Nataraja, because everything is described, the dimensions of Nataraja, the different Tandavas. There is Ananda Tandavam, but there are other types of Tandavam that he performs. He is the choreographer of our lives, and everything is in him and everything is of him. And that is what we have tried to bring out in this Bhoshambho, highlighting the Panchabhutas. We kept it simple. So how from the Agni and Surya we have eyesight, and then how from the Jala Tattva we get taste, how from earth there is smell, and how we have touch as well, and sound we have taken as the Abharanas of Shiva is described as the Panchabhuta, so the Damaru representing the sound. So all of this has been choreographed by Guru Srila Chandrasekhar, and I will now present Bhoshambho. Thank you.
Yeah.
With that, I would like to conclude today's program. I thank once more Ashavidya Foundation, Swami Brahmavidananji, Swamini Brahmapragnanandaji, for their constant love, support, and encouragement. Of course, our Pooja Sri Swami Dayananda Saraswati, father, grandfather, Guru to all of us, everything to all of us. So we are all gathered here today celebrating him through all of this. And thank you, each and every one of you. And I'm here in the beautiful Ashavidya Kendra, Bangalore, presenting this from here. So I want to thank Swami Sachidananji for all of his, he has arranged somebody to help me with all of this, otherwise I wouldn't have been able to do it. And everybody who is present, namaste.
Ishwarya, before you sign off, there are a couple of questions.
Yes.
Which some of our audiences have asked, if you don't mind.
Yes, please.
Yeah. One of them, the first question is, you mentioned about continuous sadhana regardless of anything when you started your presentation. So the question is, how do you keep yourself motivated despite fatigue, both physical and mental? Where does the motivation come from? I mean, you spoke about rain, you spoke about paining legs, you gave a lot of examples. But where does the motivation come from to keep going in spite of all this?
Well, when you're young, it's a lot easier to find the motivation because you are part mad, I will say. That madness is the motivation. I don't know what else can motivate somebody. So when I first came to India, so I used to attend Ganesh, Dr. Shatavdani Ganesh, his Natyashastra classes. And I did not know one word of Kannada, forget his Kannada. And the classes were all in Kannada. I could not understand one word, actually. But I knew that this was something very unique and once in a lifetime to be able to listen to somebody like him, such a great scholar. So I used to go, and it was always on a Wednesday afternoon at 3 o'clock. So my cousin used to tell him, this is the time you should sleep, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, not go in that traffic, dust and, this thing and sit in a Natyashastra class. So when you're young, the motivation is partly your madness. More importantly, it is the teacher whom you have. So in all of my endeavors with anything, yoga, dance, studies, whatever it may be, the teachers are the ones who have motivated and inspired me. So the teacher becomes extremely vital in the student's ability to pursue. It may not be the student's passion also, but the teacher will see a potential, like how Swamiji saw potential in me for this. So it is from them that the motivation comes to the largest extent. I give all credit to all of my teachers because whether we, it's difficult, yes, when you're hurting and all of that, but then one smile from them and, Jai Govinda uncle, Bhanumati auntie, all of them, they have treated us like their own children. So we don't want to miss that chance to be with them. So that inspires us to continue. And as you get older and the madness is sort of reduced, then that's when the test comes. How much do you love the art form? But hopefully, you know, by then you have put in so much love and enthusiasm that after that, at least I'm speaking from my perspective, there are dancers, you know, who, oh, come what may, they're 55, 60 years old. Every day they'll do their hardcore adavu practice and varnam jatis and tillana, and then they'll start abhinaya. So there are people like that as well. And I really salute them for their constant effort and maintenance of the body and all of that. But in my case, it is the art that has blessed me because I'm not such a, I would say, you know, that A type A personality to push myself and all of that. So it is purely divine grace and blessing that has kept me in it. And it's all, I feel it is all, it all evolves the way it is meant to evolve. And of course, the more effort you put, especially at a younger age, the more effort and the more you ignore those, I'm in pain and I have a fever, the more you are able to ignore that and pursue, the more blessings you get from the art, which will sustain you over time. That is how I see it.
Nice. One other question is that you mentioned about complete surrender while performing. You said, you know, you're in a state of bliss, you're completely surrendered. In that state, are you aware of your audiences and their responses, etc., or it's immaterial how the audience responds? You are just so much into your performance and you have surrendered totally that, you know, you're not aware. That's one question. And the other is, you view everything as Narayana, right? But how does it work out practically when you're performing? I mean, how does that thought work out is the question.
So the first question is about the surrender during the performance. So it is not that every performance you experience the rasa. Rasa is like one state of samadhi. So it is not that every performance that is going to be the result. That is the desired result. And we work towards that. And the attitude of surrender comes through practice. So for example, this is has been always my way of looking at it. And also Guru Bhanumati, she also, I was fortunate to find her as my guru for Abhinaya. So a lot of times we see, you know, I see some Bollywood actors, brilliant actors, but you see that person in the character. I'll give one example. I mean, it is not a discredit or anything to him. I admire his work, Ranveer Singh. So he plays Bajirao and then he plays Alauddin Khilji. So two contrasting characters, completely different from each other. But at the end of the day, though the performance is brilliant, at the end of the day, we know Ranveer Singh is playing that role. And that is valid and justified for what he is doing. But for us, we have to let go of that. So if you take on Krishna, you're no longer the dancer portraying Krishna. There should be only Krishna. When you are playing a courtesan, you're not the dancer playing the courtesan. Only the courtesan and her behaviors and her whatever you have researched about her, only that should be present. So that surrendering is a day-to-day practice. And Dr. Nagaswamy, you know, noted archaeologist and art historian, he once had told me that the purpose of the Devadasi, the temple dancers, the purpose of the dance in the temples was to invoke the Lord through the dance, just as the Lord is invoked through the mantra. So that is the practice, that is the original practice, was dance was another form of invocation. And keeping all that in mind, we try to do the surrender on a daily basis whenever we are practicing. And it happens at times, automatically it may happen. Sometimes you may experience things after the performance. So there are various experiences you get through dance because it is another form of yoga. And there are various types of samadhi you do go through. As a dancer, the more involved you are and the more you have I would say surrendered, because the more you hold on to yourself, you will not be able to have that experience. The more you're able to shed, like Dr. Padma Subramanian said, you train the body in order to forget it. Then you mentally train yourself to get into the character, so that once you have practiced so much, so by the time you go on the stage, all the hand gesture, everything is, it's already there in you. It's programmed. It is just a play, press the play button. So then you can get into the whole atmosphere of the performance. And audience also plays a big role in that. And yes, sorry, I forgot the second question.
You covered it largely in your answer. You covered both aspects of it about, audience reaction and about surrendering yourself. Thank you so much. I will now request Swami Brahmavidananda ji to please thank Ishwarya.
Oh, no. I have to thank him. No, Swamiji. No thanking me, please.
No, I am so happy I asked you to be here. I'm so happy with that. This is a beautiful performance. As I saw flashes of that rasa coming in you, because it evoked the bhava out of me. That is something. You can see that, especially in the last piece and in the piece about Krishna and Yashoda. It's so evident in someone on that. Okay. Here for you and the audience, I'd like to share something that came up with my inquiry and research into martial arts. The similarity between that and dance. You know, you have good work, footwork, so do I, you know. In a different field. Okay. That is, we say Nataraja is the source for dance. But Nata is not really dance. Nrityam or Natyam would be dance. So we did some research on this and we found that Nata was a series of movements originating from Shiva that was practiced by the warriors to keep fit. It was also called Simha Krida. From there came the ancient art of Vajramushti, Kalaripayattu and all, one form of martial arts. From the same came, for those who were more artistically inclined and didn't want the violent aspect of it, came Nrityam, dance. That's why in both you have the soft and the hard form. The Lasyam, which is the soft form, and the Tandavam, which is the hard form. So like this, from there, it also developed into yoga and many other disciplines, which I don't want to go into the whole thing because it's your talk, not mine. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it's so beautiful to see this. I am thrilled that you are there. And you know, some people even ask me, she's so young, you know, and this thing. I said, I've seen her and for the audience, her father and I were batchmates in the ashram at Sandipani many, many years ago. After that, he got married with Pooja Swamiji's blessings. I went off to Rishikesh to become a sadhu. So she's practically like my niece. Okay. And so great to see you. I've seen you before, and it's so great to have you here with us. I am thrilled. And I'm sure everyone around is thrilled with our choice of having you here. All my prayers, wishings, love, blessings with all of you. With you and your whole team. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Swamiji. Thank you. Thank you, Swamiji, and everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ishwarya. Thank you very, very much for a wonderful high energy performance.
Thank you so much. Thank you.